I would like to present our first invited speaker, Florent Karzakala from EPFL. He is a professor at EPFL and his research is in the field of statistical physics, machine learning, statistics, signal processing, computer science, and computational optics. Florent has an impressive line of research on overparameterized machine learning, including great papers on overparameterized regression, overparameterized classification, and their double descent phenomena. So this is going to be a great start for our workshop. Florent, the stage is yours. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I assume you can hear me correctly.
Yes, yes, thank you.
Perfect. All right, thanks for the introduction. It's a real pleasure to be at this workshop. Amazing title, by the way, Top ML. Very good choice of a logo. All right, so since this is the first talk, I will try to repeat some of the things we saw in the introduction, because it's always good to hear many things twice. And well, the goal of this talk is to discuss my work, but also many other works that were done over the last few years on this question of generalization. And the focus will be on insight from sample solvable models. Okay. All right, so let me go again through the whole motivation. We just heard it, but it's such a fascinating story. It's worth telling it again. That's the kind of story we have been told as students. You know, if you want a good generalization error, you should expect that you should have a bias-variance trade-off. If you have a sample model, well, you know, it should be okay, but you probably want to have a better model, so you make it more complex, you can fit all data. But if it's too complex, you are going to overfit. And I don't know about you. I had a physics education. You know, I learned about physics. And the first time I heard about it was in the story when Freeman Dyson had a fantastic theory that was explaining all of particle physics. And he visited Enrico Fermi, and Enrico Fermi told him his theory was bad. And Freeman Dyson said, but you know, it fits everything. And there is the same squat that Fermi. He said, you know, my friend John von Neumann said with four parameters, I can fit an elephant, and with five, I can make him wiggle his trunk. And we are told always the story, and it's probably a good tale. So we are all conditioned to hear this. Now, as we just heard, that's not what is going on in modern machine learning, and that's probably not true in high dimension. And we have seen many examples where you get more and more complex models, the generalization error is getting better and better. And this is an example from the work of Geiger et al. From the group of Mathieu Wayart, who's speaking tomorrow. And that's fascinating. Of course, you may say, okay, that was for MNIST with a simple neural network, but soon enough, people were able to reproduce such phenomenon with more and more complex network. This was this work by Nakiran a year ago. We reproduced that kind of phenomenon with, you know, the generalization error that goes down, go up again and goes down with a ResNet. So, you know, it's certainly not a simple model. And we all call this phenomenon now the double descent phenomenon after this very influential paper by Misha Belkin, who really, pointed to everyone where the problem was. It was an eye opener. Okay, so why is this? So there are many ways to attack that kind of problem. One is through the lens of classical learning theory. And I'm sure we are going to hear more about it because there are many people who are working in this direction. I mean, this is the main goal of statistical learning after all. Essentially, what we have is the generalization gap, so the difference between generalization and the training error. We have this amazing theorem, uniform convergence, which is basically telling us that with high probability, the difference is bounded by the Rademacher error complexity. Then you can show that the Rademacher error complexity is bounded by the VC dimension and so on and so forth. Now, the problem is that taken at face value, many of these bounds turns out not to be useful to understand generalization, and you have to work much more. And there is a really large activity on trying to make this bond relevant, and you know, people are making amazing progress in this direction. I'm sure we're going to hear more about it, but that's not what I want to discuss today. I want to take a different point of view, which is, well, let's try to see what happens in very simple models. And when I say simple, it's really simple. So my data, most of the time, will be a set of vectors in D dimension drawn from a Gaussian distribution. Okay, and the label will be given by a function that I don't know of the data. And typically the kind of question I will ask is, okay, for such synthetic sample models, for such very simple data set, what are the performances of something like, you know, a kernel method, a two-layer neural net? And that's the type of approach that is classical in statistics, by the way. Of course, people in statistics have been looking a lot to such simple models. And it's also natural for people who come from a physics background, because physicists like models, and that's my case. I mean, I got my degree in physics. So it was very natural to try to look to this approach, which is also very popular. Now, of course, it's not ideal because, you know, you are making extremely strong assumptions on the data, which are completely unrealistic, right? That are not Gaussian. I mean, real data are not Gaussian. So there is a danger that you are getting conclusions which are a bit, you know, not completely universal. But on the other hand, what turns out to be true is that if you take N and D large, often you have tractable model when you can compute everything to the constant. And there is a long list of activity of many groups in the world trying to solve such problems in various situations, ranging from compressed sensing, signal processing, and also statistical analysis. And we may hope, even though these are very specific cases, that understanding what is going on for such sample case might bring some understanding or might help to rationalize some observed phenomenon to observe empirically in reality, in real life. Okay, so that's essentially the whole mindset that I will focus today, you know, sample models. Now, the first one I want to present is learning with a method called random features. All right, what is a random feature neural net? Well, it's essentially a two-layer neural net where you don't learn the first layer. The first layer is fixed. So these neural nets are kind of popular. I mean, they are not as powerful as real neural nets, but they have been used and they have been introduced, or let's say popularized a lot to the community in this beautiful paper written by Ali Raimi and Benjamin Recht, like 2007. And they actually won a Test of Time Award with this work. So it's certainly probably worth looking at it. And you may still wonder, why do we need to study such a simple model? I mean, a neural net, a two-layer neural net is simple enough, and you know, learning the first layer seems important. And I agree. Still, we need to start somewhere. And the good thing about this architecture is that it's not completely trivial. It's equivalent to kernel methods. So if your second layer has a dimension p and p is going to infinity, this is literally the same as learning with a kernel. There is a one-to-one correspondence if you select well your activation function and your first layer. And secondly, recently there have been a surge of work following the idea of the neural tangent kernel or the lazy training. So essentially what happens is that many people have, well, maybe not many, but essentially these two groups show that if you have a wide deep neural network, so multilayer, but extremely wide, hyper, super, deeper, hyper, ultra wide, then even if you learn it, you're equivalent to an architecture like this one. So some people actually even think that this is a nice way to explain the performance of deep learning. I don't believe this is true, and I will come back on it later. But what I believe indeed is that, well, if we don't understand this, we won't understand anything, and it's probably a good place to start. All right, so I will present a work that we presented a year ago in ICML on the generalization error for such problem. It has been done with Federica Gerace, Bruno Lurero, Mark Mezar, and Lenka Zdeborova. All right, so here is the situation. We have n vector drawn randomly from a Gaussian with a trivial covariance. We have labels which are given by a function. Okay, I'm not giving you the function. It's a hidden function which takes x, the vector, take a scalar product with a hidden set of coefficient theta star, and then apply something like a, you know, some noise or nonlinearity or something. Right, now I'm trying to see what can I do if I try to learn, to do some supervised learning with this random feature model. And once I have done my random feature, I'm taking the last node, and I will try to optimize, to do empirical risk minimization on a cost function, which will have a L2 regularization and a convex cost L. That could be logistic, hinge, square loss, and so on and so forth. And the rule of the game is, what is the training error and the generalization error in the high dimension limit when the dimension is going to infinity, the number of data is also going to infinity, but and P, intermediate size, is also going to infinity. So I have three parameters going to infinity with fixed ratio, and I want to know what is going on. So brief history, there have been many, many work in this direction. And in fact, for the case of linear teacher, not a linear teacher, but certainly for ridge loss, for L2 loss, and Gaussian random weights, there have been many, many interesting work. And I'm just reviewing, you know, I give you here a very biased selection, but that was really studied a lot, especially because that case can be studied with random matrix theory. So they are really, really powerful tool that allows to solve it. And for the precise case I'm discussing now, it has been entirely solved by Song Mei and Andrea Montanari in this beautiful paper. Now, if you have more complex teacher, although that's not so hard, but if you have more importantly, a convex loss, which is a logistic or hinge, or anything more complicated than L2, it's not so easy to use random matrix theory for this approach. I don't know if it's possible or not, maybe it is, but it's not so direct. And so that's what we try to do. We started by using some heuristic methods from statistical physics. For what we know, it's called the replica method. That's what we did in this first paper. Then once we obtained the result, well, we tried to prove it, which was harder than we thought. But we managed to do it in this set of papers. And to be fair, the real hard you know, part of the proof is due to the group of Yu Lu and his student in Harvard. Sorry, here, but we are on our share. So we managed to finally solve the problem. All right, so that is the solution. It's not probably not really useful to stare at it, but essentially we have a unique, you know, there is a system of equations over 5 or 10, if you want, variable, and you have to find this fixed point. It's unique. It's very easy to solve. I mean, it's, you know, it's 10 equations after all. And just to show you where things are, well, you can see that somewhere here you have the loss function, and you can recognize here the proximal operator of the loss. Here you have the function used to generate the label that also looks like a proximal operator, actually. The Stieltjes transform of the first layer is appearing everywhere. The time you see a G here, the Stieltjes transform. And we have this coefficient kappa zero, kappa one, kappa star that are related to the activation function. Okay, but once you have solved the system of equation, then you have the answer. You know exactly what is going on. The generalization error is given by a sample averages over a two-dimensional Gaussian, and the training error is given by also a very simple expression. So everything is known. All right, so you may wonder, okay, but this is for n infinity, d infinity, p infinity, why should I care? Well, first of all, you should care because it's actually amazingly accurate even at moderate value of n and d and p. In fact, with a bit of work, you can actually prove some finite rate properties which are extremely good. And this is an illustration of what is going on. the lines here in all these four cases. So here it's L2 loss on the right logistic, represent the theory, and it's plotted together with simulations, and they are extremely close. And in fact, you don't see any differences. So you know, the theory is really useful. And we can see a lot of phenomenon here. We seem to have peaks and double descent, so it's really nice to see that. Another thing we can see is that if I use Gaussian projection or orthogonal projection, the first layer have different results. We always see that orthogonal projection is better, which is actually a known phenomena, so it's nice to be able to reproduce it. And well, that's nice. Let's try to see what we can do with it. So what is going on? And I think it's a very nice and simple setting to rationalize what is going on with you know, this double descent phenomenon. And most of what I will say is not even new here. So let's take this case, classification task, simple rule, and let's focus on the square loss. So this is a blue curve. We have this double descent here, but for a very low regularization, and the training loss is going to zero and seems to be going on at a value when the parameter, the number of parameters divided by the number of data is exactly one, right? So what is going on? So in this case, it's very simple to understand what happened. So if you go on the left, few parameter, on the right, many parameter, when P is equal to N, you have an invertible matrix and there is a unique solution to your L2 problem, okay? So this is the interpolation threshold, which is happening at exactly P equal N. How does energy or landscape or the loss landscape or the cost landscape look like? Well, it looks like what is plotted here. You know, if you are at P divided by N smaller than one, you have only one minima because the system is strongly convex. And this minima is at positive cost. When you go to exactly one, well, you have one minima exactly at zero cost. And then you start to have a larger and larger basin of zero energy solution. Okay, so if I draw the zero energy solution, this is how it looks. The space of zero energy solution is growing a lot and becomes actually infinite when P is larger than N. So we have the underparametrized, overparametrized region, and the interpolation threshold is at one. Okay, so now one thing that is key here is if there is so many solutions, when P is larger than one, which one do I find? Interestingly, when lambda is going to zero, you find the least norm solution. That is between all this set of black solutions here, the one that is found the algorithm when lambda is, you know, 10 minus 10 is the one that has the smallest L2 norm because that's what you are penalizing. So it's not any solution that you find, it's that one, very particular one, which has a very small L2 norm. And this is what is going on here. Now, why is this important? Well, that's important because if you work harder, and it's interesting, you really need to work hard, but if you try to find another solution in this whole set, it might be extremely bad. In fact, if you pick up a solution here in the middle, the generalization error will look like this. And you will not have any double descent at all, right? So the fact that you have a double descent is really strictly, you know, extremely correlated with the fact that the solution that we find by doing lambda going to zero is a least norm solution. All right, you may say, but what happens if I don't do any regularization, if lambda is zero? Turns out gradient descent then, you know, will go somewhere. And it will depend on your starting point. Interestingly, if you initialize your weight close to zero, you are still finding again the least norm solution. And however, if you initialize with very large weight, you won't, and you might actually find a bad solution like the orange one. So we see that even in a simple model like this, you know, whether or not to observe double descent depends on how we do things. And this is one example of this phenomenon which all of us are now speaking about, which is implicit regularization. You know, even if you are doing L2 and not putting any regularization, the way you do your optimization, in this case, the starting point, matters a lot. And There is always a regularization somewhere that explains the double descent. It's just sometimes not completely explicit and sometimes hidden, and sometimes you don't know what it is, but it must be. Right? And you know, I think the point is that there is no real violation of the Bayes-Lyons trade-off. There is usually a regularization that we don't know about, or we don't realize we do. And that's fundamental. Okay? Now, since I told you that our contribution was to extend that kind of ideas to a logistic and hinge, we may ask, okay, how is it different if you are using logistic loss or hinge loss? So if you are using one of these two losses and you send lambda to zero, so in the limit of vanishing realization, you have something very close but slightly different. In fact, what happened is that the transition from zero training loss to positive one do not happen at one, but much before. In fact, it's exactly the phase transition of linear separability, because what you are minimizing with the logistic or the hinge loss is trying to find a linear separation, which is much cleverer than just inverting the matrix if you have a classification problem. And this is why it's much more efficient and you need a number of parameters which is lower, at least twice lower. And we're going to see this in detail. Otherwise, you have the same kind of phenomenon when P is larger than, well, a non-trivial number, which is close to 0.5. The number of possible perfect linear separable lines grows in feature space. And you may wonder, fine, which one do I find if P is larger than this critical point? And again, that's something we know. There is a classical result by Rosé, Z, and ST, who showed that in that case, logistic and hinge converge to the max margin solution. So the fact that you are regularizing even infinitely small, you know, it's extremely important because in many ways you are finding the best separators. You are finding the one that separates but maximize the margin, which is what we want, right? So it's not any point that you find, but again, a very special one, which maximizes the margin, a very good one. And this is what's going on here. So the red curve here is the result of logistic loss with vanishing regularization. We have a peak again at a value of P over N, which is smaller than 0.5. And then we decay again, thanks to this, you know, the fact that we, between all these solutions in the black set here, we don't find anyone. We find the one that minimize, that maximize the margin. Again, if lambda is equal to zero, same phenomenon, if you initialize your weights close to zero, even though you don't regularize, you will find the max margin solution. And that was discussed in many papers, and I learned this from Natis Brero. So this notion of implicit regularization is really fundamental here, and that's essentially the thing that explained probably most of the double descent phenomena. It's just that in this sample case, we know what is going on, and in neural network, probably still not entirely sure what is regularized. So it's interesting that the difference between L2 and logistic is going from, you know, invertibility of the matrix to this non-trivial solution in which you are finding the phase transition where it starts to be possible to separate linearly the data set. So that's interesting. It's actually a non-trivial point. Cover discovered in 65 that in high dimension, if you have random label, well, the transition, then, you know, if you have random label, when P is smaller than when P is smaller than N over two, you go from non-separable to separable. So this point here is a cover transition. Now, in what we do here, because the data in feature space have an interesting structure, because you know they come from some data in low dimension that were projected in large dimension, and then there was non-linearity, the data have some structures that makes the transition at another point at 0.5, and that generalize what Cover found. And in fact, it's pretty much correlated, and it's very similar to a phenomenon that was discussed by Pragyasur and Emmanuel Candes a few years ago, when they show the phase transition between the existence of the MLE and the maximum likelihood estimate with logistic in a similar problem. It's actually the same phenomenon, except they were looking to a simpler case. And so that kind of phase transition seems to be almost everywhere, and it's very nice that it corresponds to the peak and that we can compute it, at least in such simple problems. Right, and just for the pleasure, show you what happens with logistic loss and no regularization in this case. And you can have a nice diagram when you can see what's going on with P over N. So in this direction, you change the number of parameters. And here you can change the number of the ratio between the number of points and the dimension. You have this peak here. You can see it's following a non-trivial line, and we have our beloved double descent phenomenon. All right, so this is interesting. Now that we have this model, can we say a bit more and focus a bit more to what is going on close to this interpolation threshold? And there are many things you can do, and I just want to briefly mention this work that we have done with Stefan Dascoli, who is at Facebook, my student Maria Refinetti, and my dear friends Giulio Biroli. And it's essentially trying to revisit the bias variance for this problem. Now, bias here is very simply defined. It's an unavoidable error that you can get here. Now, there are many possible sources of variances. And one of them is variance due to the fact that you are fitting noise in the training set. Another one is the fact that, well, you have fluctuation in your training set between the infinite number of Gaussian vector X, you are taking a finite fraction. You have also some fluctuations that come from your precise choice of random features. If you will be doing NTK, that will be depending on initialization. And so I call this the initialization variance. Many other decompositions are possible, and I just want to point these two nice work that generalize this idea and actually do much, they go even beyond this. And so we can compute each of these terms. And that's something we have done using random matrix theory and statistical physics method. So this is just a slide to show that we did our work. This is how it looks. But what is more interesting is what they are. So here I'll show you two cases. This is for L2 loss. On the left, you have the least norm solution. And on the right, you have the case when we regularize a bit. And so what is going on is very interesting. First, the bias decrease with our parametrization and as a phase transition exactly at interpolation at one. And this plateau that it has here is rigorously equal to the value that you would get if you had a kernel. So that's the asymptotic value. Now, two of the variances, the one due to overfitting of noises and the one coming from initialization or fluctuation between random features, display this double descent phenomenon, if you want, and they are the one responsible for the peak. They are the one who diverge. Yet, when you start to be really overparametrized, thanks to the L2 regularization, there is decay. So it's really nice because we can decompose who is responsible of who precisely in this model. And that was inspired from some very interesting work by Mathieu Wyer. I'm sure he will mention this later on. And why do I like this plot? Well, because it's not completely true that this is new, the fact that people realize that overparametrized network works well. And if you dig a bit, you can see that there are many papers when people don't say it out loud, but they say, we are surprised, we don't really quite understand. That work in 92, for instance, is beautiful. They are trying to illustrate the bias variance phenomenon on many, many, many systems, random forest, you name it. Many problems. And then they tried the neural network and they say, well, I don't know, we probably do something wrong because we don't really see the bias variance trade-off. And they make this plot when you see the total error as you increase, the number of hidden units. And you see the bias, you're having some kind of phase transition like the one I showed you. And the variance having like a peak, if you wish, which look very close to what we have here. So I thought this was very nice. And And it was really nice to dig out this paper from 92, you know, almost invented the double descent, but did not. All right, so what I try to show you in this part is that, well, you know, model of synthetic data allows to illustrate what is going on, at least for simple problems. So here for random features model, we could see double descent phenomenon. We could observe, for instance, the fact that orthogonal projection works better than Gaussian ones. We could see the phase transition of linear separability, which is occurring at the peak of the one of invertibility and not inevitability that is going on with L2 loss. And we can compute precisely what's going on in terms of bias and variances. So I hope it convinces you that there is something you can learn with these sample models. All right, before continuing, I want to open a parenthesis, make a fast comment on something. Now, of course, this is a nice plot, you know, but this is so much related to the fact that you are using this convex problem. You know, we don't learn the first layer, and the second layer is essentially a linear or generalized linear model. But it's cute, but you know, we may wonder how this looks, how this would look if you would be looking to a complex problem, you know, a two-layer network, a non-convex problem instead of the trivial one we have been looking. Now, I want to be a bit speculative here, but okay, I'll be. And you know, you may say, okay, fine. We may look how this landscape looks in complicated problem that we have been solving in computer science. And there have been a lot of activity, especially if, you know, in the direction of random instances and, you know, random optimization problem. In the direction of SAT problem, coloring problem, but also compressed sensing, statistical inference on graph. And we have seen a picture coming very often. So I want to comment on it, and maybe it's relevant for neural network. And this is discussed in my review with Lenka Zdeborova, but you know, we had like two different assignments programs on such things. And so what we find in this problem, which are all different from neural network, well, we find something like this. You know, if we look at the energy landscape in hard problems, you know, if you over-parametrize them, whatever it will mean in this problem, that would mean probably like having a large SNR. We have, of course, a much more complicated landscape. And the set of zero solution is also having more interesting phenomenon. For instance, there is indeed a true separability threshold or a SAT threshold that happens. The moment where algorithm work is very different from the one where in principle it exists a solution, and it's a phenomenon. I think I was one of the first one who, you know, called this jamming in this paper with Roré back in the days. And between these two, there are this set of solutions that we don't know how to find. In fact, there is a lot of activity in computer science proving that these are hard to find. And I think there are a lot of unexplored things here from people in computer science. There are probably connections that we should try to look at with this phenomenon. Now, sorry, that was a bit fast. There is a huge history of looking to this problem in the statistical physics community, and as I said, now also in computer science. And that kind of vision is related to some of the vision we have for the glass transition in physics. And it's really, you know, something that physicists have in mind. And there are some groups that try to explore these connections. And in particular, I think, you know, Mathieu Wyart is gonna speak about his vision tomorrow, which is also something, you know, connected with that kind of analogies. Now I'm closing the parenthesis and I come back to this simple model that I promised you. Okay, so maybe one critique that could be made to what I showed you is that it was a bit too simple, okay? It would be nice to repeat our theory for data which are a bit more complicated than just Gaussian with IID of covariance, you know, with trivial unit covariance. I mean, who cares of this? Also, the feature map is random. So random is nice, but, you know, if you do NTK, your feature map is not entirely random. If you are doing, well, if you learn and you, if you learn on some data set and then you do transfer learning, your feature map is not random. So we would like to go beyond this. So that's one of the things I've been trying to do over the last few months, and I will describe some of the results. This is done with Bruno Loureiro, Cédric Gerbelot, Hugo Cui, Sébastien Gold, Marc Mézard, Lankas Deborova, and Galen Reeves. So that's essentially the model we have been focused on. That was inspired on something we read in the paper by Asti Montanari-Rosset and Robert Tipshirani. So essentially, imagine you generate data sets. You have twin vectors, U and V. And they're Gaussian vectors, U as P dimension, V as D dimension, but they are correlated. Okay, and you have a matrix, so psi is correlation of the U's, omega is the correlation of the V's, and phi is the cross correlation between these vectors. All right, now I will use U to generate labels. And I'm giving V to my friend who is trying to do machine learning, and he will try to do supervised learning only with the Vs. Okay, so you're trying to optimize a model learning with weights here. This is really interesting. That kind of model you will see will allow us to reproduce things which are happening in much more complicated system. So first of all, okay, can we make a theory of this? Can we compute exactly and rigorously the training error, generalization error when dp and n is going to infinity? The answer is yes, this is how it looks. We define a function of six parameter, and if you compute a mean max over this six dimensional function, it's very easy, but you find the training error. Once you have done this, generalization error can be done by two-dimensional integrals using the parameter that you obtain in the training error. So that kind of result is a typical set of results you obtain with statistical physics techniques. And here we proved it using the Gordon Minimax approach, which has been extremely popular over the last decades for similar problems. All right. So. We have we know what the error is. Now, why should you care? So I think this is interesting because I want to argue that in many ways, this is kind of a universal model for learning, at least with structured data in structured feature space. What do I mean by this? So I do not mean that you can explain deep learning with this. Of course, that's not deep learning, but you can go a bit beyond what I present in section one, and I will show you how. So for instance, imagine you generate data by GANs. That's the way you generate beautiful looking pictures these days, right? So you have a generated network, you start with a Gaussian, and you generate beautiful images of dogs. So actually, this is done from, we just took a GAN from this paper by Radford, Mess, and Shintala, and generated images like this one, okay? That will again trade on Cypher 100 and Cypher 2. All right, now this is what we did. We used a teacher, so we generated labels starting from the latent space, okay? Then we go to data space, and then we apply the random feature map, but on this data, certainly extremely correlated. I mean, this is a dog, okay? Now, the claim is that there is a Gaussian equivalence principle, that as long as you are looking that vector, and you model them are joint Gaussian vectors, and you match the covariance of Z and the covariance of W, I claim that the equivalent Gaussian model will reproduce what is going on in reality when you feed this data, okay? That is a claim. It has not been proven, and we are working hard on this, and many groups are, but it works amazingly well. And this is an example, on the theory versus experiment on data coming from an example on shown this picture, so you can see it works very well. And so I think this is nice because it shows that you can make synthetic data set models, but they still it's not true that real data are completely disconnected from them. And in fact, if you feed the covariances already in such problem, you have something that you don't make the difference between real data and Gaussian. You can even go one step beyond. What we did was, okay, instead of using a random function, we, okay, again, took the data generated by the GAN, and for the label, we used the kernel that were trained on the true data set. So the label now are pretty much very correlated with the data. And now for the feature map, we use feature maps that are also learned by a neural network trained on Cypher. Okay, and now again, if you learn only the last layer, you can make a theory assuming everything works with the Gaussian equivalent principle. And it works amazingly well. This is shown here for different structured learned maps. And you see that the theory is reproducing well the classification error, the training loss, the position of the over-parametrization peak. And I think this is interesting because it shows that even though when you are looking to this idealistic data set, you're making extremely strong simplifications, you can still, if you work a bit more, and here I just fitted the true covariance, you can still model what is going on with real data set. And so I think this is saying that it's okay to use this simple model. They are still telling you something. They are able to capture many of the relevant phenomena. All right, so there is a last third point, or am I doing on time? Very good. That I want to discuss, which is coming back to the discussion of the lazy regime versus the rich regime, or NTK versus learning feature. So this last work is just appeared on archive a month ago, perhaps, and it has been done by Maria Raffinetti, Sebastian Gold, myself, and Lenka Deborova. Okay, so what is the lazy regime? We already talked about it. It's essentially connected to this neural tangent kernel, or NTK. So as I said, if you are taking a multi-layer neural network, one of the things that has driven huge amount of theoretical work has been the realization that in the limit of extremely wide neural nets, what you learn here is equivalent to a two-layer network with random weights or fixed weight in the first layer. All right. Now, one of the things that people have done is to try, that was, of course, theoreticians were super happy when it appears. Why? Because we all love kernels. It's convex. We have a theory, we have 20, 30 years of theory in it. So we start to see an avalanche of papers saying that, okay, fine, everything of deep learning is all due to this. And probably there is a bit of truth in it, but I don't think this is true. I don't think we can understand all deep learning of sample kernel methods. And I'm not the only one. And in fact, there have been very interesting papers who try to disentangle what you can do with learning, really learning things, or going to an equivalent kernel problem, especially these two works by Yashiza and Bach, and also Gorbani, Montanari et al. And Mathieu is having also some very interesting vision of this in terms of physics analogy, which I'm sure he will tell us tomorrow. Now, what I want to discuss in the last 10 minutes or so is a very simple example where we can see kernel failing and a very simple neural net succeeding. So you can see that there are things which are extremely easy for neural nets, which kernel cannot do, or they need to work much more in order to do it. And the example will be to learn a simple mixture of Gaussian in high dimension. So I like mixture of Gaussians. It's probably the most popular model of statistics. So let's do it. So that's what I will be looking at. You have four Gaussians like this. I draw them in two dimensions, but you have to imagine them in infinite dimension. And the trick is, these two here and here at the extremity will be minus, and the other one will be plus. So they form a local XOR function, if you want, in the two-dimensional subplane of their centroids. All right. So I will be working in large dimension. So D is large, But the centers, the centroids of the four Gaussians will still remain in the two-dimensional planes. Okay, so if you want, in three dimension, it will look like what is illustrated here. Okay, so now I'm doing supervised learning. What should I expect? Well, it all depends on the SNR, that is the number of points, and also the width of your Gaussian, sigma, and how far they are, mu. So if you take the ratio between the two, I call this SNR, okay? So mu will be fixed to one. So the SNR is essentially the inverse of sigma. So this is plotted as a function of the width of this Gaussian. So what error should we expect? Well, a random guess should give us an error of classification of 1/2, of course, because what a random guess does for plus or minus one error. Now, an oracle will be someone to whom I gave the position of the centroid. So it's very easy to compute the performance of oracle, because then what you will do is to cut the space and you do a first nearest neighbor method, and it's okay. If I have a new point, I look to which centroid it's closer to, and in this case, this is what you get. This curve as a function of sigma. Okay, so if sigma is small, of course, everything is close to a point. Everything is well separated. No problem. If sigma is large, at some point, well, even with the oracle, it don't make any difference. And so you have a non-trivial line, which is given here. Right, so now what happens if a small two-layer neural net learns XOR mixture? So here is the rule of the game. I'm giving many, many samples, and I'm doing HGD, seeing only sample only once, okay? And I have a two-layer neural net. I'm learning the first and the second layer. It's a true neural network. And more importantly, my hidden layer is very small, like maybe 10 units. All right, what is going on? Well, this is what is going on. You can see a movie here. So in time, you know, at first, no, I'm pretty bad. And after a while, I have good performances. And if you look the kind of boundaries, you know, you learn, you see that you start with random guess, and eventually you learn something very close to the oracle. And if you look what the weights of the neural net on the first layer are doing, they're actually learning the position of the centroid. Okay, here I have 10 of them, and you see that many of them are learning the centroid, and some, you know, some of them don't learn anything. So more importantly, you know, it works. You realize that if you were clever, you know, with four neurons, you would be able to learn everything. You know, but I used 10 here, but it was not needed. Training is fast. You see, in time, I needed something which is order one, but my time is actually in unit of dimension D. So I actually need order D sample in large dimension. Right, can I make a theory of this? Can I understand that? Can I you know, understand why I observe this with this neural network? So first of all, I cannot use the mean field equations that were derived by Suzuki, Rotzkopf, Shiza and Bach, May and others, because in this regime, D is finite, and then N, you know, the first dimension is finite, and then I project in infinite dimension. While here it's the opposite. The dimension of the data is going to infinity, and I have very few neurons. Still, it's very easy to work out what is going on, and actually the dynamic theory of learning with such neural network and sample data was done quite a while ago by David Saad and Sarah Sola in the physics literature in 95. And recently we revisited it and we just, you know, proved that what they did was correct, but you know, it was a minor mathematical increment. I mean, they did the hard work and they showed us how to do this. So we know to write an ordinary differential equation that tells us what generalization error is for this problem. I'm not showing you the ODE because it looks awful, but it's, you know, you can put it in a computer and you see it works. Here I'm comparing the ODEs and simulation. And then you can solve your ODE, try to see where it goes after a large time. And you realize, working a bit with essentially with only D example, order D example, like 10D, 20D, essentially you reach with such a small neural network Oracle-like performance. So you see the blue curve is a two-layer neural net, and the dashed curve here is also the Oracle, there is no difference. So I think we can agree that small neural networks can learn that particular Gaussian mixture in high dimension efficiently. Now, what about a random feature model? Well, let's try. This is what we did. We tried to make some simulation here using random weights and then looking at second layer and of course, changing the size of the layer. And let's see what it does. Actually, there is this nice paper that Wei, Li, Liu, and Ma who looked at the similar questions 3 years ago. And if you do the experiment, that's one experiment with random features. This is with P, so the number of random features twice the dimension, and N very, very large. Actually, we use N extremely large. So that, the best we could do. And we have the red curve, and you already see a huge gap, right? You need to go to much smaller value of sigma in our case. So we try to make simulations, we look at larger sizes and so on and so forth. And we could actually make a scaling plot like this, where for all kernel what we tried, all data can be put in a single master curve that depends essentially only on the width of the Gaussian, the dimension and the number of hidden features. And what you see is that essentially it's at some point here, when this quantity is close to one, you go from no learning at all here, like it's bad, to a good learning. But that means that to learn better than chance, you need sigma to be much smaller than essentially the minimum of the number of features or the number of data to the power 1/4 divided by D to the 1/2. Now, if you stare at this, you realize, okay, if sigma is finite, that means I cannot beat a random guess unless I have both the number of sample and the dimension of the neural net order D squared. So there is no way a kernel will learn anything better than chance unless I give him at least D squared sample. And that's something that can be actually understood analytically. It's not so hard. So why is it so? Why is it that in the high dimensional limit, kernel cannot do their job here if you have order n order D sample? Essentially because kernels are effectively locally linear in this regime. And that's something that was already discussed almost 10 years ago, more than 10 years ago in a beautiful paper by El-Karawi, that in high dimension, many kernels are just actually linear. So if you are linear, you're not doing your job. You're not bending space. And you don't give your model space to learn. And just to show you what is going on here. So this is actually how the mixture looks in feature space, projected in low dimension. And as function of sigma, you realize that unless, the mixture of Gaussian are extremely small width. Now you can see that the width is small. And so, the position of the mixture of Gaussian in feature space is now, has been distorted. So now I can cut it. But before, if the width is not small enough, when I'm here, everything is pretty much close to a linear system and a linear function. You cannot fit a XOR function with a linear problem. And I think this is a nice illustration of the limits of kernel method. So that's the conclusion of the third part. So neural net match Oracle performance in this case, while if you are using kernel method or lazy training or NTK or Gaussian processes, because once you do the math, you realize the analysis doesn't depend on the matrix you are using. It's really pretty much a limitation of kernels. In high dimensional regime, well, when D is order N, sorry, or when N is order D, you can't learn anything non-separable with these techniques. So I think this is a very good example on of a case where if you use a neural network, you can boom, solve everything, while kernel will be kind of lost. All right, I think I'm done. That was generalization in machine learning. I tried to give you some insights from simple models. I hope you find them simple enough. And well, I will be ready to take questions. I just first want to thank all people involved in this research, everyone in my team. And I want to do a shameful advertisement. If anyone is interested to work in Switzerland, we are looking for talented postdoc and student. Send me a mail. This is a view from EPFL. We have beautiful mountain and amazing lake and fantastic cheese and fondue. All right, with this, I thank you for your attention and I will be happy to take questions.
Maybe yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the great talk. So we have two questions from the audience. I will let them ask by themselves if they want. So the first one is Daniel Lejeune. I will let him, yeah. Daniel, you can speak.
Hi, Florent. Thanks Hi. Very much for your talk. I enjoyed it a lot. And so you mentioned throughout, you know, several like specific tools that people have been using so far, like random matching theory, Gordon's theorem, the replica method. I'm just wondering what technical tools are you maybe most excited about or think are most promising for the theory moving forward?
Ha, I wish I knew. Well, I would say that the most beautiful, okay. So the thing that I found more exciting now is something I have not talked about at all, which is the mean field analysis. So what, Andrea Montanari and Song-Mei did, Eric van den Heijden and Rutzkopf and other groups, which is the analysis of feature learning. So I think that is very nice because suddenly you can try to understand what he's doing with large neural nets, but including learning, which is something that goes beyond NTK. Unfortunately, so far the theory is really limited to one hidden neural networks, but I know for a fact that many groups are working to extend this. And I'm pretty sure we are going to see amazing things in that direction in the years to come. Another direction, which many people are excited, is maybe NTK is limited, but you can try to correct, to do the first correction on NTK. And that's also something that is probably reachable. And again, we see a surge of activity in this direction. So I would not be sure if I had to put my money on where would be the interesting theoretical excitement the years to come. These are the two.
Thanks.
So we have an additional question from Spencer Frey. I will give you to talk. Yeah.
Great. Yes, great talk. I really enjoyed it. I just wanted to ask for maybe just some more details on that Gaussian XOR mixture question you were talking about before. And just maybe if you could give some intuition on why the mean needs to lie in a two-dimensional subspace and how robust the either experiments or theory are to means that lie in the full d-dimensional space. And
yes, very good. All right, why do I do this? Because I wanted to find, okay, here we are. Sorry, can you see?
Yes.
But that's not, oh, sorry, I don't know why it's, all right. The reason why I did this is because that was simple, okay? Because I wanted to look at the simplest case, which is not linearly separable, but if I apply directly a linear problem, if I directly do L2 L2 loss minimization or logistic loss, it will not work. And well, which function do we know cannot be learned with a linear problem? XOR function. XOR function is really like a two-dimensional directional net. Now, how robust it is? Well, it is very robust in the sense that if you think now you have a real data set, and real data set can be approximated by Gaussian mixtures. Of course, you need many Gaussian mixtures, maybe 2,000, 10,000. But if some of these Gaussian mixtures are so close in your data set that they cannot be separated linearly, and that must happen, then the same phenomenon would again appear as the one I described here. I mean, you know, it's pretty much very generic what I discussed. Now, one thing you can do is indeed try to look at real data and some data set and try to fit with mixture of Gaussian and try to see if you recognize, you know, local points which are hard to solve. And of course, you can always find such things in practice. That you know, for instance, if you do this on MNIST, you know, MNIST is so easy that you don't really found any structure like this one. MNIST is almost linearly separable in the direct space. But I don't remember what we did. We look on CIFAR, and there are always group of points which are, you know, somewhere there and cannot really be separable. And therefore, for these guys, you will not separate them with kernels. But of course, you know, I'm not saying that kernel will not be able to separate them. I'm saying that kernel are not able to separate them if you have only a number of data points close to the number of dimension. Now, if you have, you know, if your dimension is 100 and you have 1 billion data points, kernels have no problems at all. And so it's really, the question is how much data you have.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's all thank Florent for his great talk, like in the Zoom way with the clapping hands.